Chào mừng quý vị đến với chương trình Đồng tiền thông minh trên kênh FBNC. Thưa quý vị, Guy Kawasaki là một tên tuổi quen thuộc của giới công nghệ Mỹ. Anh là tác giả của nhiều cuốn sách bán chạy và là diễn giả rất được yêu thích của những sự kiện về khởi nghiệp và công nghệ. Và trong chuyến đến thăm Việt Nam nhân sự kiện hội trại khởi nghiệp của tổ chức Việt Youth Entrepreneurs, Guy Kawasaki đã có cuộc chia sẻ với chúng tôi xung quanh chủ đề khởi nghiệp. Mời quý vị theo dõi.
Guy Kawasaki, thank you so much for being here with us.
My pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Welcome to Vietnam.
Thank you.
Well, you had a couple of meetings with the young Vietnamese entrepreneurs and the students as well.
Yes.
What was your first impression so far?
My first impression is that they're very bright people, hardworking, interesting ideas. Not a lot of difference between entrepreneurs anywhere else in the world, including Silicon Valley.
What was the typical question that you get from them?
It's about how do you pitch your company? How do you... You know, what's the most important things to do? How do you deal with certain foreseeable problems that every startup goes through? So the questions are, you know, what I face anywhere else in the world.
Sure. You've been a source of advice for entrepreneurs for many years. And I mean, the business world is changing so fast with the rise of internet, social media, digital marketing. I mean, what are some of the advices that you think that worked before but not today? I mean,
in the old world, you had to raise a lot of capital because you needed to buy time, and you had to build your own infrastructure, and you had to buy tools, and you had to pay for marketing. I think in the new world, where you're using social media, much of marketing is free, or at least very cheap. You don't buy roomfuls of servers anymore. You host things in the cloud. You use virtual teams, so you don't need as much real estate. So a lot of the costs have gone down. This also means the barriers to entry are lower. So more people can start companies, which I view as a positive. So in all, I think it's very good for entrepreneurs because the lower the barrier, the more can start, more competition, which ultimately leads to a better world for consumers.
Sure. I mean, with all that in mind, I mean, what are the top three mistakes that entrepreneurs usually make when they're young?
The most common mistake is to do a top-down financial forecast where they take a large number like the 100 million Vietnamese, and so how hard would it get to get just 1% of them to be our customer, which is 1 million, so that's our conservative worst-case scenario. And they take 1 million and they multiply by, you know, whatever their product costs or whatever their server costs.
That usually happened, right?
and it's not easy to get 1%.
Okay.
Even
1%. So what would be your advice for that case then?
My advice is you do a bottom-up analysis where you're conservative, truly conservative and honest about how many people you can really reach and how many people. I mean, there may be 100 million Vietnamese, but maybe not every one of them wants to host a website, or not every one of them wants to buy a $200 phone, or, you know, there are lots of ways that 100 million quickly becomes a much smaller number. But I think many, many entrepreneurs start from the top with a big number, and then they kind of whittle it down at the worst case scenario, but even their worst case scenario seldom comes true.
Okay.
It's worse than the worst. They take this conservative estimate and they say, well, we're going to have, worst case, a million customers. So we need to have infrastructure for that. We need support for that. We need, you know, people for that. And then, of course, the software is late. So now they have these costs that are happening, even though they have no revenue. And when they finally do ship, which is typically a year later, their worst case scenario is not what happens. It's worse than that. And so they have all this infrastructure and they run out of money because they were so concerned that they would grow too fast. And very seldom do you encounter a company that grows so fast that they could not keep up with demand. I would like to have that problem more in my life.
I mean, I've talked to many Vietnamese entrepreneurs, and I hear this, the typical concern from them that is that in Vietnam, the investor, sometimes they tend to, they cannot just invest in ideas and people, they want to see the result. If you're building a website or a mobile app, they want to see the number of the users or the numbers of subscribers, they want to see the result.
But that's true anywhere in the world.
How about in the U.S.? They told me the U.S. can just invest if you have a great idea.
I mean, you hear about those stories.
Okay.
But it's not generally true.
All right.
Today, every investor knows that there are much lower barriers to start a company. Hmm. So the expectation is that you've made progress when you show up. Hmm. And so if you believe that in the United States, you can just pitch with an idea and people throw money at you, you would be very, very, very wrong.
All right.
This phenomenon of lower costs, lower barriers to mm-hmm. entry is true around the world, and it raises the expectation of investors that they expect to see more mm-hmm. than just PowerPoint
okay.
at this point.
So what would be the most important thing when the venture capitalist or the investor, when they look at
sure.
an entrepreneur, what did you consider?
The most important thing is that you have a working prototype, a working software application, a working website, and people are already using it.
Okay.
That's it. That is game over. If you have that, mm. everything else is easy. If you don't have that, then you have to start lying. Mm. So
I've been looking back at your whole career. I mean, from jewelry business
yep.
to Apple, and then tech entrepreneurs, author, speaker. I mean, what was the most turning point for you that shaped what you are today?
Well, by far the event that shaped me the most is going to work for the Macintosh division. So Steve Jobs had a great effect on me, great appreciation for vision and passion and design and mm-hmm. you know, revolutionary change, not simply doing the same things better. So that was probably the single biggest event.
I mean, in your experience, I mean, if you want to build a entrepreneur ecosystem that can help benefiting many startups in a country, I mean, is there a model that we can learn from?
The best model, I think, for this is if you look at Silicon Valley, if you truly understand Silicon Valley, Silicon Valley's core is Stanford.
Okay.
So it's the engineering department of Stanford. So if you want to repeat a technology entrepreneurship society or success story, it starts with the quality of the engineering school in Vietnam.
Okay, so that could be a model that we could learn from.
That's the model I would use. It's not about getting venture capitalists. It's not about getting infrastructure. All that is easy mm-hmm. if you have great engineers.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have great engineers, there's no sense in having all the other things.
Okay. I mean, looking back at what you have achieved so far, is there anything that you wish you could have done differently?
Oh, I turned down many opportunities that, you know.
And if you did, I mean, how would you change what you are today?
I would not be here right now. That's,
right.
I'd be retired.
Could be more specific? I mean,
I left Apple twice. If I had stayed at Apple either mm-hmm. time, I once turned down the opportunity to interview for the CEO position of Yahoo.
All right.
When Yahoo just started. Mm-hmm. So, I've made my own set mm-hmm. of great mistakes.
Mm-hmm. What do you think is your biggest failures and what you learned from it?
You could make the case that Macintosh is a failure because it's only 5 or 10% market share. It's not 90%. I learned a lot from the Macintosh about design, mm-hmm. about when people love something, how much they will become evangelists for mm-hmm. you. I learned a lot about recognizing talent.
Mm-hmm.
So, I'm being somewhat facetious to say that Macintosh was a failure.
Okay.
But just mathematically, you could say, mm-hmm. It's only 5% of the market.
All right. How do entrepreneurs can look for a mentor, and what should they do to get out the most from a mentor?
I'm not big into mentoring.
All right. Why?
I never mentor people. But I don't have the right manner. Mm. I don't have the patience. And I'm just not psychologically
okay.
Psychologically adjusted to become a mentor. Having said that, mentors add a considerable value, I think mostly by saving entrepreneurs from making mistakes.
Mm.
But I don't want to give the impression that a mentor is necessary nor sufficient to be successful. Entrepreneurship is a lonely, difficult path, and you have to have a vision. You have to create a product or service that you love. You have to do this despite a lot of naysaying, mm-hmm. a lot of negativity, a lot of fear and doubt.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very difficult. But if you succeed, the rewards are humongous. Not just financial, but psychological, emotional, all these things.
Yeah.
But it's not easy. If it were easy, more people would do it.
I'm sure. For a startup in, like, let's say, a developing country like Vietnam or another Asian market, for entrepreneur or startup, is there anything that they need to keep in mind for the world today?
Well, my advice is that I hope that the Vietnamese entrepreneur does not simply try to make a Vietnamese version of an American idea.
Okay, so, it's like a clone, right?
Yeah, Vietnamese eBay, Vietnamese Vine, Vietnamese Instagram, Vietnamese Twitter, Vietnamese whatever. The goal for a Vietnamese entrepreneur should be to create a product or service that an American in Silicon Valley who went to Stanford wants to create the American version of a Vietnamese idea. That should be the test.
That sounds good. So what would be your one word for startup in Vietnamese?
Prototype. Just start prototyping. Mm-hmm. Not pitching, not planning, not writing plans and creating spreadsheets and making PowerPoint slides. You should build your product.
Thank you so much, guys.
All right.
Thank you so much
Thank
for
you.
Your time.